Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nazis on the Potomac, the top secret intelligence operation that helped win World War II, by Robert K. Sutton, narrated by David Colacci. Preface. Imagine that between 1943 and 1946, in the midst of World War II, there were 3,451 German soldiers and sailors, including 15 Nazi generals, living on the banks of the Potomac River, only 12 miles from the Pentagon and 14 miles from the U.S. Capitol. Thank goodness these men were all prisoners. Now, imagine that these German prisoners were interrogated by former German or Austrian Jews who had escaped from their homelands with the rise of Adolf Hitler. As far-fetched as this scenario seems, the story is true, and one of the most fascinating untold stories from World War II. The narrative that unfolds here took place at Fort Hunt Park. It was a well-guarded secret. The American soldiers stationed there were sworn to secrecy, and in time, the story might have vanished from the annals of history. In 2006, however, National Park Service staff learned the identity of one of the men who was stationed at Fort Hunt during World War II. His name was Fred Michel, and he and his wife were living in Louisville, Kentucky at the time. Brandon Beese, the historian at George Washington Memorial Parkway, which manages Fort Hunt, contacted Mr. Michel and tried to arrange a time to conduct an oral history interview. The session was on, then off, then on again, and Brandon ascertained that Fred was reluctant to talk about his experiences at Fort Hunt. He understood why. As Brandon and Park staff were beginning to piece together the story of the fort during the war, they understood that soldiers' lips and the documents related to the program had both been sealed. But now, 60 years later, the documents were declassified, and the soldiers were allowed to share their experiences. Brandon traveled to Louisville in May 2006, and in his briefcase, he carried copies of interrogations Fred Michel had conducted with German prisoners during the war with his name on them. His hunch was correct. Fred was uncomfortable discussing his work at Fort Hunt because he had been sworn to secrecy and was expected to carry his knowledge to the grave. When Brandon showed him the transcripts of his interrogations, he began to open up and talk about his experiences. At the end of his two-day oral history interview, Fred not only discussed what he had done at the fort, he provided the names of several of his former colleagues, which opened up the opportunities for multiple oral history interviews. Between 2006 and 2010, National Park Service historians from the George Washington Memorial Parkway, in partnership with the Friends of Fort Hunt Park, located, interviewed, and transcribed oral history interviews of 65 World War II veterans. Most had either interrogated prisoners or translated and analyzed enemy documents. Others had worked in the escape and evasion section, helping American airmen escape capture or providing resources to prisoners of war, POW, held in German prison camps. Several former German prisoners were interviewed, as well as German scientists who came to the United States after the war. Collectively, their stories are remarkable, giving us a window into the American intelligence operation during the war. This book tells their stories. Unfortunately, most of the interviewees are now gone. It would have been wonderful to have asked them to elaborate on some of their stories. One man escaped from a prison camp in Poland and made it back to the United States. How did he manage that? Many left Germany or Austria as children and emigrated to the United States. Some provided hair-raising details. Others offered very little. For the latter group, finding out more would have been a bonus. Still others led interesting lives after the war of which we know very little. Missing these details is minor compared to what we have learned from this oral history project. Together, their memories of their time at Fort Hunt were so vivid after some 60 years of having to remain silent, it quickly became clear that, for many, this time was a pivotal period in their lives, and the details remain fresh. While most of these men have passed away, Peter Weiss, George Weidinger, Arno Mayer, Guy Stern, and Paul Fairbrook are still very much alive, well, and as sharp as ever. Although well into their 90s, they have been very gracious and helpful, filling in many of the blanks for this story. Three of the four elaborated on their intelligence training prior to their assignments to Fort Hunt. Peter Weiss shared more details about his early life in Europe before his family emigrated to the United States. Conversely, I knew a great deal about George Weidinger's early life in Austria, but not much about his experiences after he left the army. He was gracious to fill in those details. Arno Mayer elaborated on his new life after his family settled in New York City. He shared much more about the time he spent with Werner von Braun when the German rocket scientist came to the United States. Arno and Peter were both picked up by Mamie Eisenhower on separate occasions while hitchhiking, and they wanted to make sure that I understood that both stories were not made up. Paul Fairbrook made sure I understood the nuances of how the Military Intelligence Research Service, MIRS, in which he was an integral part, worked. He sent me dozens of documents produced by his office, which filled in the holes I had encountered as I focused on this program. He also helped me understand how the German Military Documents Section, GMDS, program functioned after the war. Guy Stern elaborated on how his early life, growing up in Germany, was a great benefit to him as he interrogated German POWs during the war. He also helped me understand the value of his training at Camp Ritchie, as it prepared him for his intelligence-gathering assignments in Europe. A note about quotes. The quotes that follow come mostly from the National Park Service oral history transcripts, from interrogation transcripts, or directly from the men with whom I interviewed. In nearly every instance, I copied the quote verbatim, but in some rare cases, I edited the quote to make its message clearer. At some places in the text, quotes are emphasized. These are not direct quotes, but rather amalgamations of multiple quotes from multiple sources. So, for example, from the interrogation transcripts, opening questions and answers were similar, and by creating generic quotes, I believe I have captured the verbiage common to most. Introduction. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed to me. With silent lips she cries, give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses yearning to breathe free. Emma Lazarus. In 1654, six families totaling 23 people disembarked from the St. Catherine ship in Dutch New Amsterdam, later New York City. They were Sephardic Jews who had fled the former Dutch West India Company outpost of Recife, Brazil, fearing they would become victims of the Portuguese Inquisition. They were the first known group of Jews to permanently settle in what would later become the United States. Several years later, other Sephardic families settled in nearby Newport, Rhode Island, and eventually built the Touro Synagogue, the first synagogue in the American colonies. Through the late 1600s and early 1700s, a trickle of Jewish immigrants came to the colonies. Then, in July 1733, 43 Jews arrived in Savannah, Georgia, after sailing on the ship William and Sarah. They were invited by the colony's founder, James Edward Oglethorpe, a liberal member of the British Parliament, who opened his Georgia colony to mostly destitute English subjects. As their names, Francis Salvador, Alvaro Lopez Suaso, and Antonio da Costa suggested, they were refugees from the Portuguese Inquisition, like many of the earlier Jewish settlers in the northern colonies. One new arrival, Samuel Nunes Ribeiro, immediately used his expertise as a physician to successfully treat many colonists who were suffering from yellow fever. Another new resident, Abraham de Leon, was an expert in viticulture, producing wine, which made him an important contributor to the fledgling wine industry in the Georgia colony. During the 1700s, more Jews came to the colonies. Most, like the group who came to Georgia, were Sephardic, and like them, a large majority settled in the South, with the largest concentrations in Savannah and in Charleston, South Carolina. They were merchants, professionals, farmers, and plantation owners. By the 1830s, there were as many as 6,000 Jews in the United States, mostly in the South. After the 1830s, Sephardic Jews continued to arrive, but their population was soon eclipsed by increasing numbers of German and Ashkenazi Jewish immigrants from Eastern Europe and Russia as well. They settled in all corners of the United States and its territories, so that by the 1860s, the estimated Jewish population had expanded to nearly 200,000. Among this new group of migrants, Louis Gold and his children came to the New Mexico Territory in the 1850s, where he and his sons established the Old Curiosity Shop and Free Museum in Santa Fe. He and one of his sons joined other Jews in the first known Yom Kippur High Holy Days service in Santa Fe in 1860. In 1857, another Jew, Aaron Meyer, ventured to Portland in the Oregon Territory and established a small mercantile store. By 1870, his business had expanded to the point where he took on two brothers, Emil and Sigmund Frank, as partners. The company continued to expand until it became the largest department store chain in Oregon, known as Meyer and Frank. The Meyers and Franks were pillars in the Oregon community and active in politics. In 1930, Aaron's grandson Julius Meyer was elected governor of Oregon. But Julius Meyer was not the first Jew elected as governor of a state. Moses Alexander, in neighboring Idaho, was elected governor in 1914. Between 1860 and 1890, the Jewish population of the United States doubled to about 450,000. Over the next 30 years, from 1890 to 1920, a surge of immigration brought the population to nearly 3,500,000. As with earlier migrations, Jews were facing oppression in their homelands of Eastern Europe and the Russian Empire. However, this wave of migrants settled in cities, in contrast with earlier Jewish immigrants who had settled in both urban and rural parts of America. By the 1930s, half of all American Jews lived in and near New York City, mostly in Brooklyn, the Bronx, and the Lower East Side of Manhattan. No matter when or where Jewish people settled, from the American Revolutionary War to the present day, they have participated in nearly every U.S. military engagement. They even fought against each other in the American Civil War. When the United States entered World War II, nearly 550,000 Jewish men entered military service. American Jews, unlike many of their fellow soldiers, knew that if they were in the European war theater, they likely would face great danger, even death, if they were captured by the Germans. Several Jewish soldiers reported experiencing anti-Semitism. One recalled that he and his bunkmate had become close friends, but when he said he was heading home for the Jewish holidays, his bunkmate refused to say another word to him for the remainder of their time together. Of course, not all American soldiers were anti-Semitic. Most, in fact, welcomed them as partners in the war effort, and some risked their own lives to protect their Jewish comrades. During the Battle of the Bulge, from December 1944 through January 1945, nearly 15,000 American soldiers were taken as prisoners and sent to POW camps. A group of 1,275 enlisted men and non-commissioned officers were taken to Stalag 9A near Ziegenhain, Germany. The senior U.S. soldier of the group, Master Sergeant Roderick A. Roddy Edmonds, was ordered by the camp commandant to turn over all of the Jewish soldiers in the camp the next morning. Edmonds passed the word around for all 1,275 men to turn out instead. The German commandant was furious with Edmonds. He pulled out his Luger pistol, pointed it at Edmonds's head, and demanded that if he did not turn over the Jews, he would shoot him. Edmonds calmly said, "We are all Jews here, and if the commandant wanted to shoot anyone, he would need to shoot every single U.S. POW in the camp. He added that the war was nearly over, Germany would lose, and if the commandant shot anyone, he would be considered a war criminal and be punished accordingly. The commandant backed down, and Edmonds single-handedly saved the lives of some 200 Jewish POWs. Of the Jewish men stationed at Fort Hunt, admittedly a small sample size, none said they experienced anti-Semitism during their military service. Many Jewish soldiers, both at Fort Hunt and elsewhere, were terribly upset when the military decided to deploy them for their language abilities rather than their fighting skills. Several later said that all they wanted was for the army to give them guns to go to Germany and kill Nazis. Several Jews who served in the U.S. Armed Forces during World War II would become prominent Americans after the war. Writers Leon Uris, Joseph Heller, and Norman Mailer served and picked up some of their ideas for later work from their service. J.D. Salinger was assigned to counterintelligence, accompanying the 12th Infantry Regiment and the 4th Infantry Division of the Army. He landed at Utah Beach on D-Day and served in the Battle of the Bulge and the Battle of Hurtgen Forest. He was also present when the U.S. Army liberated Kaufering IV concentration camp, which deeply affected him. Salinger spent several weeks after the war in a military hospital for what we now know as post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. Melvin Kaminsky, later known as Mel Brooks, was drafted and served in Europe, defusing landmines left by the Germans. For Brooks, the military diet was a new experience compared to his childhood in Brooklyn. He was raised in a kosher household, meaning that his family did not mix meat with dairy products. He noticed that the other men in his unit were eating cheeseburgers. He finally decided to try one and decided that he liked this new delicacy. Carl Reiner was trained as a radio operator, but shortly before he was deployed, he was reassigned to the Special Services Entertainment Unit. For 2 years, he traveled around the Pacific Theater, performing for troops in Hawaii, Guam, Saipan, and Iwo Jima. These men, and a large majority of Jewish American soldiers and sailors, were second or third generation Americans. However, in this story, I will focus on more recent immigrants to the United States at the outset of World War II who were forced out of Germany or Austria or other areas of Nazi reach and influence. While some had relatively straightforward departures from Europe, others went through harrowing but ultimately successful experiences to emigrate to the United States. Still others came to the United States as part of a program that allowed European parents to send their children to live with relatives or foster families to escape Nazi Germany. Many of these parents who sent their children away believed that Hitler and Nazis were aberrations, convinced that the German people would come to their senses and vote these men out of office. As new United States residents, the young men and boys who had escaped from the Nazis were anxious to do whatever they could to end Hitler's reign of terror. Because of their language skills, many were recruited into or volunteered for top-secret military intelligence operations, and as such were sworn to secrecy and understood they would likely carry their wartime experiences to their graves. Unfortunately for historians, many did just that. Some had fun with the secrecy. One soldier told his wife, who was badgering him for what he was doing, that his job was to make brassieres for the Women's Army Corps. Whack. Fun aside, these men took their oath of secrecy seriously. Most were unaware that in the late 1990s the government declassified this part of the American war effort. Documents were now available in the National Archives, and the soldiers involved in the program were now allowed to share their experiences. Slowly at first, Americans started learning about these secret programs. The first exposure came when a former soldier, Lloyd Shoemaker, published his memoir, The Escape Factory, in 1990. The U.S. military was not yet ready to reveal anything about these secret programs and went to great lengths to purchase as many copies as it could to suppress the story. Shoemaker's book revealed the site of a classified operation based at Fort Hunt, Virginia, 12 miles from the Pentagon. He focused on one of the secret programs, Military Intelligence Service X, MISX, which specialized in escape and evasion. The soldiers created equipment and communication strategies to help U.S. pilots who were shot down avoid capture, or to help U.S. military POWs escape from German prison camps in Europe. When Shoemaker wrote that Fort Hunt was the site of this clandestine program, to nearby residents, Fort Hunt Park seemed to be the most unlikely place for such an operation. Located on the George Washington Memorial Parkway between Mount Vernon and the city of Alexandria, Fort Hunt is currently a popular picnic and recreation area managed by the National Park Service. Before Shoemaker's book and the declassification of World War II information, the park staff only had some inklings of what took place there during the war. To learn more about the park's history, the staff contracted with Dr. Matthew R. Laird of Cultural Resources Incorporated to research and write a historic resource study on Fort Hunt Park. In this comprehensive study, titled By the River Potomac, 2000, Dr. Laird wrote about the site from earliest prehistory through to recent development of the park. He devoted a chapter to the World War II programs at the fort, using many of the recently declassified documents from the National Archives for this chapter, which alerted park staff to the existence of previously unknown documents that chronicled the secret operations at Fort Hunt during the war. As the park began to piece together its World War II history, park staff understood that the MISX program Shoemaker described was only one of the secret programs operating there during World War II. The site was not called Fort Hunt at the time, but rather P.O. Box 1142 from its mailing address in Alexandria. Another program, Military Intelligence Service Y, MISY, served two functions. Soldiers interrogated high-value German prisoners and listened in on conversations around the fort through an elaborate electronic surveillance system. Early on, the U.S. Navy operated a similar program under the code OP-16Z. Another division, Military Intelligence Research Service, MIRS, translated and analyzed captured German documents. It shared its findings in special reports and in several editions of the Order of Battle of the German Army, referred to as the Red Book, which became an invaluable tool for the Allied fighting forces in the theaters of war. The programs were housed at Fort Hunt, but each operated independently. In fact, most men in any one program had no idea what men in the other programs did. Later, after the war, another secret program called Operation Paperclip was designed to entice high-level German scientists and engineers to come to the United States and lend their expertise to America's new conflict, the Cold War with the Soviet Union. Many of the American servicemen who interrogated German prisoners, eavesdropped on German POW conversations, or translated captured German documents were the Jews described earlier. Two themes emerged from their stories. First, each soldier was adamant that he never used corporal punishment in his interrogations of German soldiers. They used dozens of tricks to gain information from the Germans who refused or were reluctant to answer questions, but they never resorted to beating the prisoners. Generally, they found that German prisoners were often anxious to cooperate, especially toward the end of the war or after the Nazi regime had surrendered. Many were disillusioned with the Nazi cause. Others wanted to be on the American side in what they perceived as the future conflict with the Soviet Union. And still others were simply tired of fighting and wanted the war to end. Second, while the soldiers at Fort Hunt were pleased with their contributions to the war effort, they revealed that during their service they were constantly haunted by concerns for their families and friends left behind in Germany and across occupied Europe. Most had lost all contact when the war started, and many learned later that their loved ones had perished in the concentration camps. This is the story of Fort Hunt, P.O. Box 1142, and the people who did so much to help the Allies win the war. Chapter 1. River Farm Plantation, and beyond. I had rather be on my farm than be emperor of the world. George Washington. The year 1759 was momentous in the life of George Washington. At the end of 1758, he had resigned his commission as colonel and commander-in-chief of the Virginia militia, completing the first phase of his military career. He had accomplished this by the age of 26. He was now ready to throw himself full-time into the business of running his Mount Vernon farm. His brother Jack had been managing the farm in his absence, and according to most accounts, the farm was in deplorable condition. He received a big boost both to his farming ambitions and to his personal life when, at the beginning of the year, he married Martha Dandridge Custis, a wealthy widow, who brought money, slaves, and her affection into the Union. Later in the year, he was elected to the Virginia House of Burgesses, which ushered in the beginning of his political career. When he took over management of his farm in 1759, George Washington was an agricultural novice. He had worked on farms, but he had never managed an operation like Mount Vernon. From the outset, though, he did everything conceivable to excel as a farmer. He ordered treatises on crops, equipment, and every aspect of farm management. Then he purchased the newest, most advanced farm implements and what were purported to be highly productive seeds from England or elsewhere. He never stopped researching to learn the most advanced farming techniques, gadgets, and seeds then available. He also continuously experimented and tinkered, and each day he recorded his activities and observations in his diary. As an example, on September 6, 1788, he recorded his experiments with wheat crops. He was not happy with the Cape wheat because it was shriveled and bad. The imported Harrison wheat, planted in another plot, was large but not full and plump. On the other hand, local seeds produced big kernels and a high yield. Even so, he bemoaned that a strain of white wheat that he had acquired early in his farming career was far superior to any other variety. While he was away fighting in the Revolutionary War, however, the seed was mixed with other varieties, diluting the pure strain and producing lower yields. Most farmers have always believed that success hinges on the amount of land they farm. Acquiring more land is the goal. That certainly was the case for George Washington in 1760, when, fortuitously, the land to the north of Mount Vernon, across Little Hunting Creek, became available. William Clifton, the property owner, was having serious financial difficulties, and his creditors were clamoring for their money. If Clifton would sell this land, he would go a long way toward satisfying his creditors. With the involvement of the creditors in the sale, the process was complicated, but with Martha's money, plus his tenacity, that would serve him well throughout his life, George was able to purchase the 1,806 acres of land on Clifton's Neck for £1,210. He owned the land, but much of it was encumbered by tenants, whose leases were still in force, which delayed his active farming on the land. Eventually, when the leases expired, or in one case when he bought out a tenant, George Washington incorporated what he called River Farm into his plantation system. River Farm would become the future site of Fort Hunt, P.O. Box 1142, some 150 years later. George Washington's overall estate, which would grow to some 8,000 acres, consisted of five separate plantations. Like most of his neighbors, Washington grew tobacco as his major cash crop, but he quickly learned the difficulties with this crop. At that time, tobacco was sold to brokers in London at a price they determined. Some years the price was good, some not, but Virginia growers were at the mercy of buyers in the London market. Tobacco was a labor-intensive crop, which was not a major problem for George, since he and Martha owned many slaves. However, tobacco also required an abundant supply of water, especially early in the growth cycle, which sometimes was a problem, since northern Virginia suffered occasional droughts. Finally, tobacco depleted soil nutrients. Farmers like George Washington knew this, but not exactly why. We now know that the plants use more nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium than other major crops. Washington understood that planting different varieties of tobacco gave him healthier plants. Solving that one problem, however, did not resolve the other issues with growing tobacco. In 1765, George wrote to his agent in London, saying that although he raised nothing but sweet-scented tobacco, and that he was very careful in the management of it, he and his fellow Virginians were unhappy with such unprofitable returns. In his frustration, George Washington started experimenting with other crops. In his 30-plus years at Mount Vernon, he grew over 60 different crops, everything from varieties of wheat and corn to rye grass, hop clover, guinea grass, hemp, Jerusalem artichokes, field peas, and potatoes. He also planted special forage crops to feed his livestock, such as Siberian melilot and sainfoin, which were both in the pea family, and burnet, another forage crop, which, with its deep roots, served as a soil stabilizer. Corn and wheat were particularly important as cash crops, as feed for his animals, and as the main ingredients for his whiskey distillery. Each of the five Mount Vernon farms was managed independently. Slaves with an overseer were housed on each farm. Most worked exclusively on that farm 6 days a week. On Sunday, they mingled with friends or family on other farms. Washington expected his slaves to work hard, but he was opposed to whipping them as punishment. We would like to think that he was against this practice for humanitarian reasons, but it was mostly because he did not believe this provided any beneficial results. He fed, clothed, and housed his slaves, but in some cases he would break up families to meet the labor needs of his farms. George Washington's quote at the top of this chapter is very revealing. He looked at his military and political careers as duties and services to his country, but his passion was farming. He was happiest when, each day, he would saddle up and ride through his five farms, seeing how his experiments were progressing, making sure his fences were secure, checking his crops to make sure harvest was timed when the grain was at its peak of ripeness, and generally ensuring that everything was running smoothly. From time to time, George would sit down and develop management plans that served as guidance for the coming year and well into the future for each of his farms. The last plan he prepared was on December 10th, 1799, only days before his death. In addition to the action plan, he listed the slaves on each plantation, their ages, their relationship to each other, and whether they were his or Martha's slaves. 57 slaves lived on the river plantation, 30 belonging to Martha, 27 to George. They ranged in age from 1 to 80. 19 were children, 36 were workers, one was a cook, and one was listed as past labor, too old to work. George Washington's program for River Farm was extensive and thorough. For the year 1800, he laid out what he envisioned for each plot. For the following 3 years, he sketched out general guidelines. River Farm was divided into 8 plots, with about half in crops and the rest for pasturage. He was precise as to which should be planted in wheat, which in corn, which in rye or oats, and which should grow potatoes or turnips. Some of the pasturage should be open, other parts fenced. Runoff from rainstorms was a constant problem. He directed that litter, straw, weeds, or other kinds of rubbish should be scattered and planted to stabilize these areas. In his experimentations, he found that mud from the local streams served as a good nutrient for his corn crops. Animal manure, as fertilizer, produced bumper crops of potatoes. He also learned that gathering up residue from harvests into mulch piles made excellent fertilizer. Farm animals ought to be kept well littered, and the stalls clean, as well for the comfort of the creatures that are contained in them, as for the purpose of manure to be collected and used for fertilizer. At the end of his guidance for the river farm and the rest of his plantations, George Washington made it very clear that the plan he laid out was not optional. "There is one thing, however, I cannot forbear to add, and in strong terms. It is that whenever I order a thing to be done, it must be done." He went on to say that if an impracticality is discovered, why the task cannot be done, a countermand or change must be suggested immediately. Further, if it was determined that the project was not completed, or for some reason could not be done, either of these is unpleasant and disagreeable to me, having been accustomed all my life to more regularity and punctuality, and know that nothing but system and method is required to accomplish all reasonable requests. Clearly, Washington had every intention of implementing his annual work plan, just as he had done for many years previously. But 2 days after putting his ideas on paper, on December 12th, he mounted his horse and did something of which he never grew tired, which was to ride the circuit around his farms. The weather was dreadful, starting with snow early, changing into a cold and heavy rain. When he returned home, he dined with guests without removing his wet clothes. The next day he had a sore throat, but thought nothing of it and walked down to the Potomac River to scope out an area where he intended to build a fish pond. During the night, he awoke with an inflamed throat, woke Martha, and complained that he was having difficulty breathing. In the morning of December 14th, his symptoms grew worse, and his family physician, Dr. Craik, was summoned from Alexandria. While waiting for the doctors to arrive, Washington asked one of his men to bleed him, a barbaric practice that generally made the symptoms worse. When Dr. Craik and two other doctors arrived, they continued bleeding the patient, probably removing about 5 pints of blood. The youngest physician, Dr. Dick, recommended a new treatment, which we now refer to as a tracheotomy, to ease Washington's breathing. The other two physicians vetoed the procedure. As the day progressed, the great man grew worse and died. In his last minutes, George Washington had his finger on his wrist, feeling his pulse as his life ebbed away. George Washington's plans for the future of his river farm and for the rest of his plantations were not fulfilled. Gradually, the land was divided among family members or sold to others, and Washington's carefully orchestrated management quickly deteriorated. By 1834, an observer visited the farms and wrote that more widespread and perfect agricultural ruin could not be imagined, yet the monuments of the great mind that once ruled are seen throughout. The ruins of capacious barns and long-extended hedges seem proudly to boast that their master looked to the future. By 1850, the Mount Vernon mansion and surrounding farmland belonged to George Washington's great-great-nephew, John Augustine Washington III, who could no longer afford to keep the estate. But he also recognized its importance to the nation and offered it for sale to the federal government and the Commonwealth of Virginia. Neither was interested, but Ann Pamela Cunningham, a young woman from South Carolina, took up the torch to preserve Mount Vernon, and started a national fundraising effort in 1853. Her effort was successful, and by 1859 she had raised the necessary $200,000, an extraordinary amount for that day, to buy Mount Vernon. The Mount Vernon Ladies Association of the Union has continued to manage Mount Vernon as a private operation ever since. Mount Vernon and its 200 surrounding acres were secure for posterity, but the land associated with the river farm continued to pass through multiple owners. Change came in 1885, when Congress recognized that the coastal defenses nationwide were in deplorable condition. During the Civil War, in April 1862, a Union field artillery battery, set up on a sand spit across from Fort Pulaski in Savannah Harbor, Georgia, had easily breached the masonry wall of the Confederate-controlled fort in a day and a half. The vulnerability facing field artillery or the armaments on modern naval vessels plus the reality that most of these masonry fortresses were not well maintained, and in some cases were crumbling, concerned many members of Congress. They authorized President Grover Cleveland to appoint a commission to develop recommendations for new fortifications. President Cleveland appointed the Board on Fortifications and Other Defenses, generally referred to as the Endicott Board, named for Secretary of War William C. Endicott, who served as chair. The board confirmed what Congress already knew. The nation's coastal defenses were inadequate. The Endicott Board submitted its report to Congress in 1886, recommending an expenditure of $127 million for new state-of-the-art defenses at 29 locations at port entrances and in coastal areas. One area of particular concern was the harbor entrance to Washington, D.C. Fortress Monroe and Fort Wool continued as the primary defensive structures at the mouth of Chesapeake Bay. Up the Potomac River on the Maryland side, just upriver from Mount Vernon, Fort Washington continued to stand but was of little defensive value. After the Civil War, the War Department had upgraded Fort Foote, built as part of the circle of forts surrounding the nation's capital, as the last line of defense to protect Washington, D.C., but it was inadequate as well. Clearly, the Chesapeake-Potomac waterways needed significant defensive upgrades. As the Endicott program moved from plan to implementation, the fortifications demonstrated the era's genius for military engineering. The primary weaponry consisted of breech-loading rifled artillery on disappearing carriages, firing 6 to 14-inch shells. The rifled tube would sit on a carriage below a 20-foot-thick reinforced concrete parapet. Earthwork would slope down from the front apron of the parapet. When fired, the gun crew released a mechanism raising the rifle above the parapet on a hydraulic system. Upon firing, the recoil pushed the barrel down where it would lock, ready for reloading. The whole sequence would take seconds. Fire control towers triangulated and coordinated targets so that the weapons achieved pinpoint accuracy. In addition to the disappearing guns, many coastal systems also included 12-inch mortars and smaller rapid-fire weapons. Underwater mines, then referred to as torpedoes, rounded out the weapon system. These weapons were placed at the bottom of the estuaries and were electrically detonated. The board recognized that Fort Washington was still in an important strategic location and thus should remain and be rearmed with the latest Endicott system weapons. It recommended spending over $1.3 million on the fort, plus other defenses on the Potomac. The War Department concluded that the best location for an additional fortification was on the Virginia side of the river, directly across from Fort Washington, on land that had once been part of George Washington's river plantation. If the landowners were unwilling to sell the roughly 300 acres needed, the government had the authorization to condemn the land and pay up to $500,000 if necessary for purchase. The government condemned and acquired the necessary land in 1893. Plans for the new fort and its armaments were completed in 1896, and the construction commenced in 1897. With delays, the major features of the installation were completed and operational in 1899. Fort Washington and this new fort would be the last line of defense against an enemy vessel that somehow made it through the defenses at the mouth of Chesapeake Bay. The weaponry from these fortifications, plus the minefield, were designed with so many overlapping elements, any enemy ship commander would rue the day he had decided to attack the nation's capital. Fort Hunt was the name for the new fort. It was named for Brigadier General Henry Jackson Hunt, who had served in the Mexican War and the Civil War, when he was brevetted Major General as Commander of the Artillery for the Army of the Potomac. His last post was as Governor of the Soldiers' Home in Washington, D.C. The principal armaments were 3 8-inch rifles on disappearing carriages located in Battery, Mount Vernon. These were complemented with 2 5-inch rapid-fire guns on pedestal mounts, Batteries Robinson and Porter. Battery Robinson was named for First Lieutenant Levi H. Robinson, who was killed in an engagement in Wyoming Territory in 1874. Battery Porter was named for First Lieutenant James Porter, killed in the Battle of the Little Bighorn in 1876. A fourth battery, Battery Sater, was added later, completed in 1904, and named for Lieutenant William A. Sater, killed in the Battle of San Juan in the Spanish-American War in 1898. More than 30 buildings filled out the fort complex, with everything from officers' quarters and enlisted men's barracks to a hospital, stables, a mess hall, recreational facilities, including a bowling alley, a power plant, and a guard room. The military was also able to reuse several buildings owned by the previous landowner. When Fort Hunt was fully operational, it was manned with the 47th Company of the newly formed Coast Artillery Corps. Manpower was never more than a company, 80 to 120 men, and for most of the time the commanding officer was a captain. On occasion, Fort Hunt would sponsor joint training exercises with other Coast Artillery Corps companies. The U.S. Army had no way of knowing this, but just when Battery Sater was completed and became operational in January 1904, the Endicott period Coast Artillery System had started down its road to obsolescence. On December 17, 1903, the Wright brothers successfully flew their Flyer at Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. With the elaborate precautions military engineers had designed to protect gun batteries from naval attacks, the eventual ability of airplanes to drop bombs on the forts could not be overcome. By World War I, the guns from many coast artillery forts were shipped to Europe as railway guns or scrapped. Such was the case with Fort Hunt. The electronic mine systems and the gun batteries associated with those systems were still practical, but not the rest of the armaments. Fort Hunt was never fired on in anger. That was true of all coast artillery forts in the continental United States, with one exception, Fort Stevens in Oregon. On June 21, 1942, when a Japanese submarine surfaced near the mouth of the Columbia River, and lobbed several shells in the direction of the fort. Ironically, although these Endicott period fortifications were quickly out of date, the presence of the substantial concrete gun emplacements remain and likely will continue as curiosities for generations. With its armaments shipped to Europe, and with new defenses constructed on Cape Henry at the mouth of Chesapeake Bay, Fort Hunt no longer had value as a coast artillery fort. What does one do with a military installation that is only 20 years old and close to the nation's capital? At first, the buildings housed troops stationed in or near Washington, D.C. For a brief time, Fort Hunt served as the finance school to train enlisted men to work in the new War Department Finance Department. The school showed promise, but never reached the goal of the desired number of trainees, and was eventually discontinued. In the 1920s and early 1930s, Howard University used Fort Hunt for Summer Reserve Officers Training Corps, ROTC, training. Some years, students from Wilberforce University in Ohio used the site as well. Students spent 6 weeks in the summer, stayed in the barracks, and trained with small arms. Multiple proposals came to the War Department for the fort in the form of federal or municipal government proposals, and others came from private entities to use the land and the facilities. The District of Columbia was interested in using the site to train National Guard soldiers. The U.S. Department of Agriculture considered turning the site into a plant experimental station. The city of Alexandria wanted to use the site as a park, including a bathing beach on the Potomac. One of the most intriguing proposals came in 1923, when the Roosevelt Military Academy in Englewood, New Jersey, thought about relocating to the Washington, D.C. area and specifically utilizing Fort Hunt. Members of the school's board, including Colonel Theodore Roosevelt, Jr., son of the former president, supported the proposal. The negotiations ended when the school recognized that it would incur substantial expenses to convert the facility from a fort to a school, with no assurances that it could eventually own the land and facilities. At the same time the Roosevelt Military Academy ended negotiations for Fort Hunt, a new proposal surfaced that would become important to the future of the fort. In that year, the United States Commission for the Celebration of the 200th Anniversary of the Birth of George Washington was established by an act of Congress to commemorate the life of President Washington as farmer, soldier, and statesman. As one of its projects, the commission proposed constructing a highway that would connect the Memorial Bridge in Washington, D.C. to Mount Vernon. Not only would this provide a safe and scenic route to Mount Vernon, it would make Fort Hunt much more easily accessible. Construction started in 1929 and was completed in January 1932, on the eve of the anniversary of Washington's birth date. As construction of the Memorial Parkway, later the name was changed to the George Washington Memorial Parkway, was underway, the nation fell into the worst economic depression in its history. To deal with the crisis, President Herbert Hoover did far more than any previous president had done during an economic downturn. He immediately encouraged businesses to commit to spending $1.8 billion on new construction and repairs to existing facilities to increase employment. He pushed for a $160 million tax cut and doubled federal spending on constructing new buildings, dams, highways, and harbors. Then, in 1932, Hoover signed the Emergency Relief Construction Act, which loaned $300 million to the states for relief programs and $1.5 billion for public works projects. The programs helped, and in 1932 it seemed that the nation was beginning to emerge from the crisis. In reality, these early efforts did little to ease the economic crisis. Between 1929 and 1933, the stock market lost nearly 90% of its value. Unemployment went from 3% in 1929 to 25% in 1933. During the course of the Depression, average family income dropped by 40%. Some 11,000 banks failed, and many Americans lost their life savings. In the early stages of the Great Depression, Fort Hunt continued as a former military installation that did not seem to have a purpose. Gradually, however, the fort played a greater and greater role, housing a program that would be a backbone in federal relief programs. Following World War I, veterans started lobbying Congress for additional compensation for their service. In 1924, Congress and veterans agreed to a plan in which the government would invest funds so that by the target date of 1945, each veteran would receive a one-time payment of about $1,000. The program made perfect sense when the overall economy was healthy in 1924, but as the grip of the Depression became stronger and stronger, with many veterans out of work, they started a push to receive their compensation sooner. In the spring of 1932, Walter W. Walters, from Burns, Oregon, a former sergeant in the war, whose small business enterprises had failed, organized a march to the nation's capital to lobby Congress to move up the bonus payment to unemployed veterans sooner rather than later. His call for a bonus expeditionary force attracted veterans from the West Coast who gathered in Portland and started their journey to the nation's capital. They rode in freight cars, hitchhiked, and walked. Along the way, others joined, so that when the Army reached Washington, D.C., there were some 20,000 veterans, along with family members and other supporters. The marchers were allowed to erect makeshift shelters in three main camps and several smaller camps. One group stayed on Pennsylvania Avenue near the Capitol, around buildings that were slated for demolition. The largest group built its village east of the Anacostia River and south of the 11th Street Bridge in Anacostia Flats, currently Anacostia Park. The third encampment, completely independent from Walter's group, was the Workers' Ex-Servicemen League, made up of American Communist veterans. They were camped at 14th and D Streets in Southwest Washington. Since the veterans were unemployed, they were in no hurry to return to their homes. Conversely, Congress was in no hurry to consider or meet their demands for bonus money. As time stretched from days to weeks, District of Columbia Police Superintendent Pelham D. Glassford, who was a World War I veteran and sympathetic to the veterans, grew concerned about the health and sanitary conditions of the camps. The issue came to the attention of President Hoover, who directed Frank T. Hines, the administrator of Veterans Affairs, to create a 300-bed hospital for the marchers at Fort Hunt. The Army, under the command of Chief of Staff General Douglas MacArthur, quickly prepared and furnished Fort Hunt to serve as a hospital. This was one of the few positive stories from the march. On June 17, 1932, the Senate defeated a bill passed by the House of Representatives.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.